do it a little bit, but I think we're gonna show on the road.
Yeah, in just a couple minutes. Just to help Vincent out, since we've got don't have to have a packed house necessarily today, if you guys can kind of move up a little bit so Vincent's not having to kind of shout quite so much. So if you don't mind, just kind of fill in the seats up front a little bit. We're gonna get started in just a few minutes. So yeah, Vincent, you want to take your
question? Sir, was that right?
If you would like to take your question.
Oh yeah, sure, just for fun. Yeah, so if anybody has any questions, just feel free to throw it out. You know, we'll just do the traditional, like raise your hand and you know, point to somebody. And of course, you can ask questions after as well. It's not official, but yes. Oh, and you might as well, I think everybody already knows you, but you might as well say your name.
My name is Jeff Miller. I have a blog called Alaska Naturally, and we do natural alternatives to chemically weighted products. So sometimes I'm to help people figure out what solution to request to them. And my husband works with me. And I'm just added. So I have a question about something, how Pinterest works. So one time I was going to throw a Back to the Future under the seat party, and I pinned this one pin. And I get a notification nearly every day that someone else has repinned that pin.
Yeah.
It's something that I repinned, not a pin that I generated. So my question is, how am I the one getting the notification? And if I pinned it from somebody else, did they get the notification? Like, how did it become my pin?
Yeah, the moment that you repin something that's from your account, it's technically your pin in that sense, right? What is supposed to happen is that basically, it's almost like a lineage. You know, so when someone repins your pin and then somebody else down the line repins that pin and that pin and that pin, then you kind of get credit for it, which will sometimes actually but sometimes you'll also notice that, it's kind of a weird system because you'll find that your pin will outperform other people's pins.
Of the same thing.
So I'm not gonna lie, I don't know exactly how that works, like the algorithm, but I do know that when it gets down the line, or people might search for it. Like, here's a funny thing too. This is what happens a lot too. When your pin starts getting traction in terms of repins, and there's, let's say it's a specific word, like you're saying it's Back to the Future under the sea theme, right? And let's say someone decides to search for Back to the Future. They're like, and they see your pin, yes. And they'll go, oh, well, I see Jess's pin on search results. I'm going to pin that. And through search, people end up keep finding your pin. Versus the other person, because they didn't necessarily get the same repin traction. So something I'll kind of talk about later is like the repin concentration actually matters a lot in Pinterest search, which I'll talk a lot about that too today. It's a lot of people don't really kind of realize like how like such a visual search engine Pinterest is. So if that person says, let's say they get 10 repins in a week, and yours, because you pinned it, might have a bigger fan base, and then it gets like 100 repins within that week. Pinterest goes, hey, you know, this pin is awesome. We're going to give it to like the Back to the Future search. So people will go Back to the Future, they'll search it, they'll pin it, and you can get a lot of traction that way as well. And that's why that person may not necessarily get credit as well. But it's a little bit of a mystery to me how it exactly works. Because you're right, it doesn't make sense because you repin it from somebody, and then that person doesn't get the same amount of repins.
So then it makes me wonder if I generated a pin like from my blog or something. And then, or I'm the one who puts the text on it, but then she repins it, then all the repinning, I don't even know if there's any value being the one that gives the repin, but it just was interesting to me. That it was just something random that I had pinned, and then all of a sudden I was like, and I get notifications on it.
Yeah.
Make sure it's linked to your blog.
Yeah.
That's important. Just make sure to link to your website. And here's the thing too, I think a lot of people get caught up in it's like, well, my particular pin didn't get the 500 repins. The thing to keep in mind is that Pinterest actually has like a cumulative number, so they will know, like they know that your pin that you might have started or that's linked back to your blog specifically, they'll have like a weighted scale for that as well.
Okay. So it doesn't matter who repins it.
Technically, it doesn't. It's like to me, at the end of the day, it's like if you have a fan that repins it and they get 10,000 repins, but it's driving traffic to your blog, which is like extremely common. Then that's great, you know, because they're ranking high in Pinterest search results and they're driving traffic. So to me, it's kind of like a co-op community. It's like, hey, let's help each other out. To me, it doesn't matter as long as it's getting there. That's for sure.
Is this gonna be a general Pinterest question, or
We're just kind of getting the audience warmed up. I think it usually makes people feel easier if there's like a Q&A before, so they can go, okay, I can talk to this guy. That's cool. Mm-hmm. All right, so, but yeah, of course.
So I'm a local blogger who blogs with some recipes and patterns and stuff like that, interacting in Alaska. I noticed that sometimes you put a pin and you'll have a recipe with all the ingredients. Do you do something special to get that, do you know?
Yeah, so your name is?
Natasha.
Yeah, so Natasha is a local food and recipe blogger, is that correct? Yeah, what's your name of the blog?
I'm a knitter, so it's Alaska Knit Nat.
Okay, Alaska Knit Nat. So her question was that sometimes you'll see like these pins, and then when you see the pin, you get like these extra information where it says, okay, like 2 ounces of vanilla extract or like ingredients after that. So what you are referring to is rich pin for recipes. Rich pins for recipes, for those that are food bloggers, what they do is they will literally list the ingredients that is required to make that recipe. And so there's a word, are you using WordPress by chance? Yeah, I think, don't quote me on this, but I think the WordPress plugin is called Siplist. That you can take a look. I think it's a premium plugin, so you do have to pay for it. But what it'll do is, yeah, it'll list the ingredients, and so it makes you look extra cool.
I know.
It does, yeah. But it does actually help traffic. It's actually been shown that the rich pins for recipes will actually help garner additional traffic, because once you have rich pins for recipes, it's almost like a verification that this comes from your site. It's not somebody that kind of did a switcheroo, right? So,
thank you.
You're welcome. I'm just kind of curious, how many people here brought like a device that's connected to the internet right now? Okay, that's good, because we will actually be using it today. So if you have a bad internet connection, just let me know. We'll try to improvise along the way, but a lot of it will actually be kind of hands-on. So I would highly suggest that if you have a Pinterest app or the desktop, just to kind of get that started. I'm not the type that I want to talk all the time, because everything is relevant to your specific business, and you should see pins that are in your space, not necessarily my space. That's not a my space joke. I'm serious.
No pun intended.
Can we get
blogging
information for the
Wi-Fi? Oh, do they have? Do participants have blogging information? Or we're not doing that?
He's our Pinterest expert, and yes, he's already heard all the jokes about the guy being the Pinterest expert, but Vincent really got on board with Pinterest back when it was first in beta testing in 2010. How many of you guys knew about Pinterest and started way back in the beta phase, where you had to email somebody to get permission to join Pinterest? Yeah, that was back in the beta phase. So Vincent's been working with them since then and really caught the vision early on for what Pinterest could do for inbound marketing. And that's really where his focus has been. He's been invited to speak at the social media marketing world, and just he's had great reviews in different places that he's spoken, and it's part why we're really excited to have him come and be a part of this today. So with that, I'm gonna give the floor to Vincent. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, I know, it's always one of those weird moments like, okay, do I clap? Or don't I clap? Like, I hear like a little bit, should I? And then everyone's like, no, it's not loud enough, let's stop. You know, it's always, you've been there. It's like, if you've ever been a speaker, like, I should clap. I don't want him to feel lonely. But guess what? It's too late. I feel lonely. You didn't clap enough. Thank you. I'm like an angry Canadian. I don't know if it is by coincidence, I am Canadian, and they put me in the Yukon room, which I was, sorry? Are you? Oh, okay, perfect, yeah, so that's good. So I don't feel so lonely. Let's talk a little bit about today's presentation. It really is how to use Pinterest to drive more traffic to your site And after all, this is really about inbound marketing. How do we attract people to your e-commerce platform, to your blog post, or to your company's website? And I'm hoping to be able to show you that today with Pinterest, because there's just so much power in visual social media marketing. But before I jump in, I want to talk a little bit about myself, because I'm selfish, I'm a speaker, I can talk about myself. If you want to talk about yourself, you can come up and tell me your life story. I'm totally cool with that as well, of course. But this is here is my lovely wife, that's Yukari, and this is me on the left-hand side, and that tiny little itty-bitty tower is the Eiffel Tower. And so when I was proposing to my wife, I asked her a long time ago, honey, if you had a choice between getting a nice diamond ring or if you could get a trip to Paris/Barcelona, which would you want to choose? And being the adventurous type, she's like, you know, I would rather you spend money and take me to Paris and Barcelona, because Barcelona was her dream destination. And so we headed off. And so basically what happens is we're landing in Paris, and we had talked about this for months. You know, it's like, oh, I'm going to propose to you, or I'm not going to tell you when, or when exactly. And so day one in Paris, she's expecting me to propose, and she's like, nothing. You know, we're at the Eiffel Tower, it's nighttime, it's like, is he proposing? She looks like this gypsy girl, like so cold, you know, with a scarf on. Day two, day three, and literally it's day four of Paris, and she's pretty much almost given up hope. I was like, this guy is not going to propose to me. He's probably got cold feet, and you know, he's probably just trying to tease me. So day four arrives, and we are in a cozy Airbnb apartment, tiny apartment, and she gets up, and she says, what are you thinking? And I look at her and says, I think we should get married. And she looks at me, and then I go, it's like, what do you think? And she says, yes, I think we should. And I think she's utterly confused, because this is not exactly how she imagined her proposal to be. And I'm confused, because I'm just getting up, and I'm like thinking, it's like, okay, when should I propose? Now that she's asked me what I'm thinking, like, why did she ask me that? Like, it's such a terrible question. And I get the ring out, and this is, like, totally bad, because I've got to take off the price tag of the ring. So she looks at this, and she says, oh my god, the price tag is there. It's like, you should take it off before. I'm like, you're right, I should take it off. Only to find out that because I'm a little bit nervous and I'm a little bit groggy, I take the right side of her hand to put the ring on, and she gives me that look again. It's like, you're confused. And she says, you know, she's like, you know, that's the wrong hand, right? So finally, I get the left hand side, and I put the ring on, except I put it on the middle finger. I don't know what I'm doing. I am really majorly screwing this up. But finally, I put it on the ring finger, and finally, you know, she said, yes, we got married, and that kind of, now we're happily married. This is about 2 years ago. A few of you may be wondering, well, why are you sharing your personal life story, and what does this actually have to do with Pinterest? What's really interesting is we were planning our trip to Paris and Barcelona using Pinterest. We were looking for articles, looking for places to visit, and we would use Pinterest as this virtual, visual scrapbook to list the things that we wanted to do. And see, what's really interesting is that we're still doing that now. We're planning a trip to Disneyland, and I'm checking out blogs to find out the 60th anniversary of Disneyland. Because the reality is, and this is what's going to scare you, is that 39% of active users on Pinterest will actually use Pinterest to search for something first before they go to quote-unquote traditional search engines. So before they go to Google, before they go to Bing, or like Marcus would like to make fun of the Yahoo families, think about 39%. And I guarantee you, and I want you to raise your hands, how many people are actually doing that right now, that they go to Pinterest? So take a look around the room, keep your hands up. They go to Pinterest first before they decide to go to Google or Bing. See, that's actually, if you think about it, you might go, well, that's not a lot, right? But if you got a 20% raise in your job, that would be a pretty good raise, wouldn't it? So you can imagine if there's 39% of people that are doing that, that Pinterest is a serious heavy player. So I'm just kind of curious, is there anybody here that does not know anything at all about Pinterest? You don't need to be shy. Perfect, because these slides are for you. I always want to make sure that I'm prepared for somebody that may not be familiar. So Mom, what is Pinterest? Pinterest is really, it's a visual discovery tool. A lot of people, as I said, they love using Google, but when you go on Pinterest, you get to see things firsthand. You get to see what recipes look like. You get to see what they call, you get to see Pinterest fails, so those really bad cakes of minions and those frozen parties that just gone terribly awry. They discover those things on Pinterest, and you get to see things. That's the awesome thing. You can see things in person before you decide to start a project, or you might be searching for shoes. Google, not so great for that, because Zappos or some other shoe store is going to show up first. It's a place to dream about the future. I know everybody that uses Pinterest here knows how Pinterest is famous for planning weddings. I mean, it's crazy because it is like literally the place to be for brides to be that are not even brides to be. Like, it's like, oh, I want to plan out my wedding and I've got everything down and my future husband is going to do this. But it's a place to dream about the future, and it's a place to really invigorate the imagination to see what's actually possible, to make what's possible. And this is what's really powerful, because when we talk about Twitter and we talk about Facebook or we talk about other social networks, where do any of these social networks lie in terms of the actual future intent? Very few. Because if you went to Facebook and you said, by the way, I want to show you all the pictures of my future wedding before it happens, people on Facebook would go, you crazy, you crazy. But if you go on Pinterest, it's like, I feel comfortable. This is my crowd, you know? Like, I'm planning my wedding along with, you know, tens of millions of other brides-to-be who are not brides-to-be. And it's a virtual scrapbook. People love to collect things. If you love cute animals, you can do a collection. If you love, again, if you like World War II vintage posters, you can totally find those things on Pinterest as well. So it's a great way to create a virtual scrapbook. Now, in terms of what Pinterest looks like, this is a pin. It's a simple picture, has a description. That's all it is. The equivalent of a tweet, equivalent of a Facebook status. Each pin needs to go specifically to a category. In Pinterest talk, that's known as a board. And so you can have up to 500 boards. I don't know why people would, but you can. If you can do 500 boards, that's amazing, because I can't think that far. But every pin must go onto a board. And eventually, for those that haven't logged in, this is what it looks like. You have your boards, all your pins belong into them. So let's talk about the juicy stuff. Let's talk about why this workshop is so awesome. Not that those ones aren't. Like, I love Vivica and I love Andrea, but why should my business use Pinterest? And I think these stats and what I'm about to reveal is gonna really kick some major butt. So here's a quiz for you. And just so you know, people are gonna say, okay, well, where's Facebook in all this? Facebook is king of social referral. You can't beat Facebook, not for a long shot. But out of these social networks, which one drives the most referral traffic? Is it A, Twitter, B, Pinterest, C, LinkedIn, D, Google+. Yeah, so, but overall, what do you think in terms of the global scale, if you really thought about it? Good. So it's not LinkedIn, but I appreciate you playing. There's no consolation prize. It is Pinterest. So here's what's scary. Pinterest, it's a Pinterest workshop. Pinterest drives this more referral traffic than, guess what? It is the queen of social referrals, and I will tell you why. Because it drives more referral traffic than Twitter, LinkedIn, Google+, Reddit, YouTube, and stumble upon combined. That's right. Eat it, Twitter. Eat it. Oh, by the way, if you're a stockholder for Twitter, you really got to get out now. So, but what I'm saying is, here's the crazy part. Pinterest actually drives 4 times the amount of referral traffic than Twitter. And where are we in the social media space right now? We are still focused on text-based social media when the world of visual social media is out there and the stats don't lie. 5 to 6% of the global social referral traffic is coming from Pinterest. It is the new reality. People keep talking about Facebook, as they should. But where is Pinterest in all this? Have you thought about using Pinterest? Of course, with every social network, you gotta think about strategy. You gotta think about whether it really applies to my business. And I truly believe that Pinterest applies to every business, simply because every business uses pictures. But let's get down to the granular. So here's the interesting thing. This is done by eMarketer, and it talks about the frequency with which US active Pinterest users, people that have logged in the last 6 months, purchase products digitally by category. So what this study shows is that Pinterest users are digitally savvy. So those that are actively using Pinterest, they have actually bought a food or recipe product within 1 week. So usually once a week, 22.2% will have bought something digitally. 21.4% will buy something at least once a month. For fashion, 11% once a week. So you can kind of see all the stats there, beauty, health and fitness, home decor. So what this says is that it's saying that, guess what? You, if you're an e-commerce site and you're not on Pinterest, that's you should be, because these people are digitally savvy. They are buying products online. So I'm going to take a, I think I have a quick question. Is that right?
Yeah. So are you saying, because you can't purchase directly from Pinterest, correct?
So you can, with some exceptions. But we'll talk a little bit about that later. So if you can come up to the podium after, we'll talk a little bit about that in more detail. But
so is this people purchasing through Pinterest directly, or people going to people who are advertising or have pins on Pinterest?
So for this study, what they're saying is that these are just people who use Pinterest and who coincidentally buy a product digitally as well. So for example, like if it was a Twitter user, it might be a different statistic. But what they're saying that by when you're reaching out to Pinterest users, these are the types of people that are digitally savvy. They're already buying stuff online. So it might be that fact that they went to an e-commerce site already, but they're just coincidentally Pinterest users as well. So it's more of a coincidence versus this is what people are buying directly from Pinterest. But it's great to know that these people are digitally savvy. They don't have problems buying e-commerce products. They don't have problems doing all that stuff. Now, you might go, okay, this is all for offline. That's all good and well, but what about offline shopping? What do people do offline? This is crazy. So product categories that US active Pinterest users have browsed on Pinterest via mobile device while shopping in store. This is nuts. People will actually go in a store, look for a food product, or look for ideas for a food product, and scan on Pinterest and go, I need to buy something. I don't know what to make for dinner tonight, but I'm gonna use my Pinterest to help influence my in-store purchase. So food products, 57%, recipes, 53%, arts and crafts, products, fashion and clothing, home improvement. So what you'll probably notice, for example, at the very bottom, exercise, fitness, gardening products, what you will notice is that Pinterest is heavily focused on a lifestyle. Whether it is food or it's home decor, it's a way to improve your life. And when you have a product or you have a page that caters to that, whether it is travel or whether it is about makeup and skincare products, guess what? People are interested in that online and offline. And that is what's incredibly powerful. Because think about, when was the last time that someone says, I'm gonna go into, you know, Office Depot and go check on Facebook for something, or for Twitter on something. But they might go to Office Depot and just take a look at, hey, like I can actually do this with my kids. I need these products. So this is what's really powerful about Pinterest. And I think people love this stat. They love the fact that, hey, so how much money are these Pinterest users actually making? 41% make between 50 to 74K, around there. So, and that's a lot of money if you think about it. And then 30% makes $75,000 or more. So there's money that's being spent on Pinterest. There's money by these families. And honestly, the only network where the average income is more is LinkedIn. Pretty much it, based on the studies I've read. And that's understandable. I mean, it's hard to compete with the CEO of some oil company. Let's be honest, right? So let's talk about the goals for the workshop today. My goal is to show you 11 ways to drive more traffic to your website, kind of nifty tips and tricks. But on top of that, I want you to get involved with actual Pinterest exercises. So we'll kind of take some breaks in between. You'll be able to see what's happening in your industry. And I know for a fact that by the time we are done, you will get some excellent insights, not only in what is happening in your industry, what is popular, what's working, you will get insight into what type of visuals your industry competitors are making that are also popular. And this is something that, if you think about it, was really hard to do before, because if you try to get a visual idea of what your competitors are doing, you had to go through all their blog posts, you had to go sift through all this information. That's a lot of information. But what's really powerful about Pinterest is that it is the world's largest visual focus group. It is. Think very hard about that. It is the world's largest visual focus group. If you need to see what's popular in terms of blog posts and visual creation, you go to Pinterest. You can't do that with Twitter, you can't do that with Google, but you can do that with this. So the very first tip that I have is when it comes to Pinterest is you gotta see what's hot. And I'm not saying you're trying to see what's trending. What I'm suggesting is that you're trying to look to see within the pins if there are specific colors that keep coming up. And this is really important. So if you're selling an e-commerce product or any type of product retail, you're looking for specific colors that come up. And I guarantee you will see them again and again. You're looking for specific shapes. This is kind of odd, but I guarantee you that you will see common shapes. So if you look for, again, a chair, you're probably going to notice that the designs are somewhat similar for some certain reason. But the shapes play a very important role. Same with background. If you're in the travel space, right? If you happen to be advertising about Alaska, you can type in Alaska tourism and look for the common backgrounds that are being already used, because Facebook is a visual recognition engine. This is crazy, but Pinterest will actually recognize your image and categorize it to belong to somewhere else. So if they look at a picture of a cat, they go, we know this is a cat image, you can't label it as a dog image. So they will know, so you want to use that to your advantage. But I'm happy, I think there's a question.
Yes. Do you look for the commonalities within the topic of the board that you're pinning in, or the industry? Because we're a nonprofit and we pin about a lot of different things that we're up to that may not necessarily be under the common, like someone looking for creation ideas to bowls for an event that we're doing is not necessarily the person that's going to be searching for homelessness in Alaska for our nonprofit.
Yeah. So basically, the common theme is we don't really have a product to sell, but we have a service to provide, whether it's nonprofit or for profit. Can this apply to me? So we're going to go with that into the next one, which will apply more to the nonprofit sector. I'm trying to cover some ground for e-commerce. But for example, if what you want to do is you just want to search for terms that you believe your customers or your audience is searching for. So if it is happens to be nonprofit, you can type in things like nonprofit fundraiser to look for, again, the same color themes, see if things pop up. In this case, what I did was I searched for birthday cards. And by the way, if you don't have your laptops out and you're not logged into Pinterest, now's a good time because we're going to do an exercise and you're going to see some really great stuff. But over here, you'll be able to see that this is balloons, it's a birthday card. What will happen is if you notice very carefully and you scroll very carefully, you will see that the color themes of red, orange, blue, purple, darker blue, those colors come up again and again every sixth pin. I'm not necessarily saying the shape of balloons will come up, but the colors will come up again and again for birthday cards. And what that's saying is that it's not only just Pinterest people that are loving it, it's the fact that everybody is loving this. So you really are looking for that type of color scheme, especially if you're in the e-commerce products. So let's kind of stretch our Pinterest muscles a little bit. And what I want you to do is go to your Pinterest account, and I want you to search for something that's relevant in your industry. Again, if you're in the nonprofits, you might want to type in nonprofit fundraisers, or if you're in the space that you're selling health products, type in health products. And I want you to notice very carefully if you see any color schemes that pop up, any shapes. Especially if you're in the e-commerce space, notice what the background is like. Because there's been a really interesting, I think, misconception that people want to see products in a white space. But Pinterest will show you exactly like how many times things get repinned when you have a really great background. So just feel free to take a few minutes, take your time. And if you don't see any color schemes, that's actually possible as well, especially if you're in the service industry. You may not see that. We're going to go into that as the next step. So what's something that you might also notice is that some people also have a style as well. So for example, recipe blogs have a very interesting format. You will see that what recipe blogs will do is that they have a food photo on top, they'll have a text in the middle, and the food in the bottom. And that has now become the common template. The recipe space, especially for Pinterest, has become so saturated. It's extremely competitive. Yeah. From your blog, right? Is it a different image? Is that why? Or same image?
I think the best thing I do is I search, I go to one of my pins, and then I say that I pin myself in my own blog. And then I say, up on the side, it says, look at other pins from this website.
Yes. Yeah, it's so basically what happens if you ever go to Pinterest, you can actually see what other people have pinned, especially on the desktop version. There's a small area that says what people have pinned from your site. So I'm just kind of curious. Please don't make me feel lonely up here. It's like my biggest fear. But did anybody notice some of the colors and shapes that kind of popped up? It's kind of fascinating. You never really think about it until you look at it in detail. And when I say looking at it, I don't mean look at 10 pins. Literally scan through to look at like 100 pins. And you will start to see the colors and the shapes and all that. And so you are using this visual data to now create potential pins for your clients, for your business, that you know works. That's the thing. You know what works. Because there's 70 million people using Pinterest. Why would you reinvent the wheel? Right? And again, if you're worried that, hey, I don't want to be them, then look for other color schemes and other shapes and other templates that keep popping up. So tip number two, you want to be a tease. Here's a question. Does anybody actually know what that is in the background? Take a guess. It's not shells. Octopus, that's good. It's not octopus. Starfish. You were right on the ball with everything. Seriously, I swear, we did not rig this. It's not like that. It's like, I know the answer. It's Pinterest. It's a starfish. It was not like that. But it is a starfish. And so basically, what happens a lot in the world of Pinterest is that people will tell you, create infographics, because infographics are awesome. I'm going to tell you, infographics are great, but nobody clicks on them. Nobody. Because why? You've given them everything. Why would you give somebody everything? You wouldn't. You shouldn't. You need to be a tease. And what I mean by that is that, let's say that you have some great information. Let's say that you created a blog post. It is about a nonprofit society, and it's about the top 10 ways to help the homeless, right? If you give all that information in an infographic or a pictorial graphic, you list all 10 reasons, they go, oh, that's fascinating. I already know the 10 ways to help homeless. I'm not going to click through. But if you tease people by creating these long pins and having, let's say, each image being like one, hey, this is number one, this is number three, this is number eight. What you're doing is you're giving them enough information just to be curious, but you're getting them to click through. So it's almost the idea of what they call clickbait. And so some people will do this where they say, top 13 ways that you can rock, whatever it is, right? And says, but number six is like the most amazing, so click through on this if you want to find out. Much shorter, of course. But that's the idea. And so over here, I designed this for a travel site. So Matador Network is one of my clients. And this is 15 sites to see on Booth 66. I create this long image, and what's really great about this is that this pin itself was pinned probably about 2 months ago, and that individual pin has received about 1,200 repins. And it generates approximately a few, I can't disclose the exact number, but I can tell you it does every month generate a few extra hundred visits directly to their site. But I did, just so you know, all that I'm talking about today, until the very, I think the ones about promoted pins, is all organic. Yeah, I'm a big organic, I'm big on organic when it comes to Pinterest, because it just goes on and on forever. But this is what it is. And so tease people. If you got a blog post and it's doing well, take that extra effort to create a longer graphic, tease people with it, and drive people back to your site. So number three is focus on the pain. You know, when we talk about focusing on the pain, it can be several things. But really, when I say focusing on the pain, you want to focus on what people call evergreen pain. Right? What is the pain that they keep having again and again, that people keep searching for again and again, that will allow people to literally repin again and again through the years? If you can focus on the pain and know exactly what your audience is looking for, you will see, and I guarantee you, if you do this quite properly and you're being patient, you repin and you distribute, you will see some amazing results. So over here, this is from Home and Garden Television, and this is about 20 smart kitchen storage ideas. Doesn't seem like a big major pain, but it is. People have trouble storing things in their kitchen. They want to know an intelligent way to store stuff. And with this 20 smart kitchen storage ideas, this helpful article, which is a great resource, has approximately 7,984 pins across the Pinterest sphere. So this is the total amount. This individual pin itself is 4,018. So this one individual pin is responsible for that. So this is a pin that I designed for my client using the principle of teasing. It's this one right here, Hip to Save's Packing and Moving Tips. So there's a lot of tips on that blog post. And let's be honest, people move all the time. Every single month, somebody is moving. Some people move every single week because their roommates hate them. Whatever it is that you're doing, again, focus on the evergreen pain. What is the problem that you can continually solve and create a great graphic for that? How can you tease people? And if you're wondering how successful this pin was, this particular pin right here, I don't have the bit long, but this one here, not cumulatively, just that single pin, has been repinned 14,000 times. 14,000 times. And I can tell you, it's funny because we're a couponing site, that's what we do, but it is this particular pin that actually drives the most traffic as an individual pin itself. And if you're curious, I can't disclose the exact numbers, but I can tell you it's over 10,000 per month, just that single pin alone. So when you are solving this evergreen pain, and you're solving it where nobody else is solving it, I guarantee you, with a little bit of patience, you're going to see some great traffic with it. So here's another quiz. I love quizzes. How much daily traffic to Pinterest comes from mobile apps? Is it A, 50%, B, 68%, or C, 80%? You can't guess anymore. You can't guess anymore because you're like. Not that I'm trying to be rude, it's like, yeah, give other people a chance. Give other people a chance. Answers?
68.
Sorry, what was that?
68.
No, it's not 68.
88.
It is 80. It's that weird 80-20 rule. I don't know why. But 80% of the daily traffic to Pinterest is on mobile. That's crazy. It's crazy because when I first started off, it was more like 50-50. Now it's 80%. So when you are designing your pins, and this is so vital, you need to design your pins to look great on a mobile device. And that means for the majority of you and the majority of the people I've worked with, this is gonna freak you out, but 50% of their traffic comes from an iPhone device. 50%, I'm not saying that as a solid stat, that's just what I've noticed within the different industries I've worked on. So if you are creating these pins, whoops, let's get blocked.
That's part of the reason why
infographs
are terrible. Infographs? You can't read them.
Yeah, exactly. So when you look, like, if you want to see a bad example, take a look at infographics, because then I just want to call it like the dreaded squint, right? You know what I mean? It's like the dreaded squint. Like, I can't read that. You know, I can't read. What is that? You know? And see, so when you are designing for mobile, the one thing that you got to keep in mind is, obviously, number one, make the picture nice and long, which we'll talk about a little bit more. But if you're going to use a text overlay to describe something, like let's say that you create a pinnable image for your blog post, you got to make sure that that text is clearly visible to read on your hand. Test everything out. If you've created pins before, take a look at them now, see what they look like, and see the text. If you can't see it, you need to redesign it. Why? I just told you, 80%. 80%. iPhone, that's 50%. It's crazy. So make sure that your pins are nice and long. Make sure they're visible. Don't use the horizontal pins. I don't know why. Actually, what really upsets me is to see people pinning horizontal pins, because I'm like, you're just throwing away traffic. Don't do that. Create long pins. These are pins from Apartment Therapy. I love it. It's gorgeous. You get to see everything that's happening in this kitchen. And we're also creating pins, and this is especially true for e-commerce products, is that you want to be able to use images with multiple colors. And when I say by multiple colors, think about the background that you're using as well. Does it create a sense of dimension? Because, for example, a lot of times you might see some products do very well in a white background. That's great. But if you really start observing, like, across the board for e-commerce products, you'll notice that easily that they usually have some kind of background. It could be a wood background, it could just be some kind of gray background, but they usually have something. So you want to make sure that you're using multiple colors to make your images pop and come to life. For those that like to be exact, they're like, I need an exact kind of thing, I understand. A 2-to-3 ratio is considered standard when you're creating a pin. It's not necessarily always the best ratio. It really depends on what you're creating, but this is kind of accepted industry standard. So that means that width to length, so if you have an image that's 200 pixels wide, you want to make sure it's 300 pixels long. And that's just generally the standard. If you're interested in knowing the exact pixel that will allow you to occupy like the whole screen on a desktop version of Pinterest, 735 pixels wide, 1,102 pixels long. So that's kind of the exact measurement. But feel free to fool around. I'm not saying that you have to use these dimensions. You might find that if you want to use 600 width, go ahead, use 600 pixels as your width. There's no real iron rule out there. It's just some people like to know what's the exact pixel width and length. That's a great question. Is this ideal for desktop and mobile? Yes, this is ideal for both desktop and mobile. What you'll find is that if you create, let's say you create an image that has 300 pixels wide, it'll look really great on mobile. It'll fit the space, but it'll kind of shrink on the screen of the desktop. So you kind of have like these little white sidebars that come up. You'll have to test that out. A lot of it is really testing. So for those that, again, if you're a small business, maybe you can't afford like really great graphic design tools when you're creating pins. Canva is free to use. They now have Canva for Work, which is a paid service. Another one that just came out in terms of graphics is called Relay That. So you can go relaythat.com. I know Craig Carpenter, who's responsible for that, is doing some great things with it. And PicMonkey is another great resource for creating images. If you're wondering, just so you know, this whole thing actually is designed on PicMonkey. Not one thing did I use on PowerPoint, honestly. So you can actually do some really cool stuff if you start learning the tools. So this is really interesting. So this is what we talked about with the recipes. But rich pins are awesome. Rich pins are awesome. When Target decided to convert their pins into rich pins, they saw a 70% spike in traffic, right? And many of you might be wondering, okay, what exactly are rich pins? Well, rich pins are not your normal pins. Rich pins provide extra information that lures people to say, you know, click on me. Click on me. And what I mean by that is, here is an article. So rich pins for articles. There's rich pins for articles, rich pins for recipes, rich pins for movies. There's place pins, and there's rich pins for products. There's a lot of different types of rich pins. But the ones that matter most to everybody here, I guarantee you, well, I shouldn't say everybody, because recipe rich pins matter. But what you're probably most interested in is article rich pins and e-commerce rich pins, product rich pins. And when you look at this Social Media Examiner article, what you notice over here is that this particular title is bolded. So right below your image, it'll have a favicon. So usually the logo that's listed on your website, it says it's from Social Media Examiner, 5 ways to succeed with Pinterest promoted pins. Now, the bolded title for articles, when you compare that to this one here, so you have this infographic that's really difficult to read on a mobile device, which nobody would probably read. You notice that they don't have that bolded title right there. It's not there, it's missing. So you have to honestly ask yourself, from a perspective of a Pinterest user or a potential customer, which one are you most likely gonna click? Are you gonna click on this one here that has the bolded title? Or are you gonna click on this one that has no bolded title? Right? And so these right here are known as regular pins. This is a rich pin. Clicks naturally will increase if you change your blog post into rich pin content. Now this is what I love, and this can be a little bit tricky because I'm not a coder, I'm not a programmer, but if you get rich pins for products and you have to apply for them, is that they will take information from your site, just like they did from Anthropology, and they will tell you if an item is in stock, they will tell you the price of the item, which you control, and they will also bold the product title. And so what this does is that automatically it eliminates people that are looky-loos, that aren't interested in what you have to sell, but you know right away that, hey, this person is interested in what I have to buy because they click through. Because I have to admit, $134.40 for a quilt, you know, that's a type of thing that either you're gonna be interested in or you're not. But what's really powerful, and this is why I love Pinterest, and no other social media network will do this for you for free, is that if you have rich pins for products, and let's say that your product drops by 10% in price, guess what Pinterest will do for you? Sir? No, well, they do update. They'll update, they'll tell you what's on sale, and if a person has repinned that e-commerce product, and they allow for notifications, sorry? They send out an email and a notification. They will do email marketing for you. I had a friend, you know, it's funny because I live in Canada, and she gets an email saying that, by the way, that dress that you repinned from Nordstrom's 8 months ago is now on sale. That is so cool. Like, what other social network will do that for you, that when you drop your price and somebody that has repinned an item from way back and say, hey, we bet you're still interested. Do you wanna buy this product now? And here's the thing. Guess what the commission is for Pinterest when they do this? Zero. They take nothing. How awesome is that? That's awesome. So the question is, how do I get rich pins? How do I apply for it? So this is the website, HTTPS, all that jazz. It's business.pinterest.com/en/richpins. You do need a business account with Pinterest. It's really easy to do. If you go to business.pinterest.com in general, you can switch over from a personal to a business account. But just watch out for that. We can talk about that a little bit later if you have questions about how to do that. But again, apply for rich pins. If you don't have them, get them, because I promise you, you will see a spike in traffic. Nope, they cost absolutely nothing. What they cost is your time and a little bit of computing effort. That's all it is. So that's a great thing. And so here's the advantage of rich pins as well, which most people don't talk about. For those that use Pinterest and have created Pinterest content, you'll see this happen as well. How many people have had their pins hijacked, where you created a pin and you know it's your pin, but someone has redirected it to a different site? Yeah, anybody had that experience? Yeah, yeah. It's so annoying. So annoying. And you can imagine that that sucks as a business if someone hijacks your image to redirect to that site in China that's selling those fake Gucci bags that are made by some cousin of mine, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. Could be. I have cousins in Hong Kong. But the reality is that when you get rich pins, guess what? If someone tries to alter the direction of that URL, which we're going to talk about a little bit later as well, that rich pin content, that bolded title and those price listings disappear right away. So what you're doing in a sense is that you're protecting your content and to let users know that this is genuine. Yeah. So when I work for Matador Network and travel, actually a lot of times specifically look for only rich pin content to repin. I'm not saying you have to, but it saves me a lot of time because I know for a fact it's not going to lead to a spam site. I know it's legitimate. That's why you should get rich pins. Tip number six is you gotta provide your pin with a sibling. You know, if you have like an awesome pin, you know, how, like if you got one that you just absolutely love, it gets lots of repins, and you kind of start noticing, hey, you know what, it's kind of going down in traffic, there is no reason that you cannot create a second image that links back to your same website. I'm gonna show you how to do that exactly. But over here, this is a pin I created. Why don't my pins show up in Pinterest search results? Four tips to make them more searchable. This thing got 1,000 repins. Over time, it kind of waned. So I said, you know what? I'm gonna create a whole new pin with a whole new image and use a whole different headline. How to get your pins to show up on Pinterest search results. Totally different, but it drives back traffic to the same website. So now, instead of having one pin that's going viral, potentially, now you have two pins. And because one image is going to apply to one type of audience, and then you have another one that's going to apply to a second audience. And so you can imagine, if you really want to, you can create five images for your blog post if you find it's very successful on Pinterest. Where it's extremely helpful is that how many people here have an e-commerce site? I'm just curious. Okay, so where it's extremely helpful is that you have those, you know, you have those extra product images that just lie around and you're like, I can't put that on my website. Or maybe, for example, you're a wedding photographer and you have those extra wedding images, again, that you want to drive back to your site, but you can't put them on your website because there's just too many of them. Well, what you can do now is you can upload them to Pinterest and you can literally redirect them. When you're on the desktop version of Pinterest, click on the edit and then click on website, and you can actually change this to any URL that you want. Any URL. This is why spammers get to you, because they can hijack their pin and redirect it to their site. But for e-commerce owners, for bloggers, for anybody that wants to create lots of images to drive back to your site, you can do this with any URL. And the great thing is that once you have rich pins, let's say you have rich pins, any image that you use that connects to a rich pin article will also become a rich pin as well. So that's a really great thing. Question?
So in this case, are you uploading a photo and then putting the
URL? Yeah, so basically,
pinning from a website.
Yeah, so if you pin directly from your website, then what will happen is that it will automatically generate the URL of your website. But let's say that you just want to upload some images, especially for products, you have maybe like an extra 20, you would go to Pinterest, upload them, click on the edit, and then change it to the URL that you specifically want. So when you think about that creatively as well. So if you happen to, for example, let's say that you are working for a nonprofit organization, and again, things are just changing so fast, you can actually create a pin that leads it back to like a category of a blog. So instead of having it be a specific blog post, it could just be like ways to help out people in Alaska, right? Like it's a very generic thing, but you can link that back to a category page, so that way when you update that category, people are seeing the newest blog post for that as well. So you can be creative. If you got 500 categories and they're all popular, create custom pins for that. So tip number seven is don't be afraid to repin your popular pins. So this is a very common question. I've created a pin, it went viral the first time. Should I repin it on, number one, the same board, and should I pin it again on like a variety of different boards? The answer to both is yes, you can do both. This is how you spread, I would say you get more clicks to your website. Don't be afraid to repin it, I would say, onto the same board a month later. Usually a month is a good time, depending on the frequency of pinning. So obviously, if you only pin to that board once with that image, and you go back and you pin the same image consecutively a month later, that's not a really good strategy. But if you've been consecutively pinning, and there's been like 30 other pins or 20 other pins on that same board, repin your popular pin, get more traffic to your site, and then look for boards that you can also repin that pin onto. So for example, when I work with the travel industry, I might have a board that's about South America, but I also have a board that's about travel tips. So I will literally schedule one day, it'll be for the South America travel board, the second day, it'll be for the travel tips board. Right? And so when you're creating Pinterest boards or categories for your business, you almost want to think of like, okay, what kind of boards can I create that are similar but still different, so that when I create pins, I can actually try to pin them on as many boards as possible.
You said scheduling, you can schedule pins?
You can, and we're gonna talk a little bit about that as number 10, so we'll talk about scheduling pins. So number 8 is perform a magic trick. And this is a little bit, this will require, I would say you need a coder, but it helps if you have someone that's familiar with JavaScript. But this is a really cool thing. I'm telling you, when I discovered that, this is so awesome, especially if you have a blog post. So over here, this is the site for Hip2Save. So Hip2Save, the coupon site, has usually, again, like they have this particular pin that you see here. And it's all great, and it's pinnable already. But what you can actually do with Pinterest is that using a little bit of coding is that you can actually get people to pin a different image specifically for Pinterest. So what I mean by that is that if you have a blog post and you like to keep those horizontal images, you can do that. And yet when you have someone that decides to pin something like an illusionist, you go, whoa, where did that come from? You can actually get them to specifically pin this type of image. And so what that means is, for example, if you happen to, again, if you are working, let's say you're working in the travel industry, and you've noticed that, again, you don't want to use a really long image because it irritates people, right? Like they don't want to see the infographic to start. They just kind of want to see what's there. So it might be top 10 travel tips when going to Alaska. And then what happens is, using some coding, which I'm going to give you a website that you can check out, when someone pushes that pin it button, it'll load up that extra longer infographic about, say, top 10 travel tips when going to Alaska. Here's tip 1, here's tip 3, tip 7. So that way, when everything goes on Pinterest, it's an optimized teasing type of image. And if you're not technically savvy and you don't want to do coding, the great news is that there are some plugins that you can try to explore that will allow you to do this. Social Warfare plugin is one of them. So it'll allow you to have one pinnable image that's behind the scenes, but also have like a very specific blog post that you can have there as well. Another one is Phil Dirksen's Pinterest Pin It Button. Both of these are premium plugins. You do have to pay for it. But if you are really good at coding, what you can do is, just want to make sure everybody's got this down, what you can do is you can actually do some coding. It's not as hard as it seems, but it takes a little bit of while to get used to. And you can visit Pinterest's official site. It's really long, but you can actually go to bit.ly/Pinterest Society, and it'll redirect you into a process of how to actually get like one image for your blog post, but when someone pushes the pin it button, how to actually extend to get a longer one. The hard part is actually starting off. That's what I found. It took me about 2 hours to kind of understand what was going on. But once I did, it's like such a lifesaver. It is worth putting the extra time and effort in.
Can you go back to the slide?
Yeah, absolutely, of course. Any questions so far? Yeah. Is everybody doing okay? Is this a lot of information? Yeah, this is awesome. Oh, thanks. May I, yeah.
What was the third design, graphic design tool?
Oh, that was PicMonkey.
Oh, sorry, what was the second one then?
That was RelayThat.com.
Thank you.
Enough, probably a little bit. I'm not an expert in it, but I use it myself. So here's the thing about Canva as a tool. It is, because it's free, it can be helpful. What you want to do is you want to make sure that you're not designing it to look like everybody else's. When you use a free tool like Canva, the problem is that over time, you will notice who's using Canva. It's crazy. You'll notice that, wow, it's the same templates, the same fonts. So what you want to do, and let me see if I can go back, just kind of show really quickly. Okay, so if you're curious, I actually designed this in Canva. So I used their fonts. I used my client's logo. So the goal is, when you're designing things and if you're using free tools, is not to make it look like everybody else's. You want to try to make sure that it stands out. It has its own design. But it, I like it. Yeah. Get me. Yes. Yeah, because they're like, it automates everything, which is what I love. Okay, so this, I'm not gonna lie, this is what I'm really passionate about. This is what I'm getting really jazzed, is search optimizing your pins. If there is something that I love, it is visual search on Pinterest, and I guarantee you, by the time you walk away, you're gonna go, I know some of this stuff, and I'm gonna share some stuff that probably you're never gonna hear from anybody else. For a little while, at least. So when you are search optimizing your pins, because the fact that, again, it is a visual search engine. Think about it. When you go to Pinterest, do you usually automatically go and check out as many boards as possible? Or do you go search for things that you're interested in, that you need to make that night, that you need to do with the kids that weekend, or you need to plan a vacation? Whatever it is, you usually type, like Google. Huge opportunity that most Pinterest marketers are not taking advantage of. Very few really understand how Pinterest search works. And so what I tell people is, when you are making your pin descriptions, do not aim for one keyword, aim for two or three keywords. And what I mean by keywords, I mean search terms that your customers or your audience is looking, is searching for. And so over here, this is really tricky. So this one is about 35 of the places to swim in the world's clearest water. So what I decided to do was, okay, and this is a typo, I typed in 34. But what's really crazy about this is that, you know, I think this pin is going to do well. So I'm going to put in the words Honduras, Philippines, and Panama just to see if it will do well for those search terms. So what happened was, I noticed that as this thing got more and more repins, that it actually started ranking well for the word Honduras. So when people are looking for Honduras, this pin will show up not at the top, but near the top. It also shows up for the word Philippines. That is really cool. See, that's the thing with most people. They aim for one, you want to aim for two, because guess what happens? When your pin gets more and more repins in a very short time, this is what here's one of the tricks of the trade that most people do not know. Get as many repins as possible from active users on Pinterest to get your pin to rank for a search term. It is simple in explanation, but pretty damn hard to do. But if you have an email list of 2,000 people and you can get 100 of them to repin all that stuff within 24 hours, and you have, let's say it might be blue shoes for women, then it ranks much faster, much higher.
So when you put a search term in, and there's a
So the long tails, you can do some long tail, but it's not that great. Like, you'll probably get some really crappy results. The reason is that, because here's the interesting thing with Pinterest. Actually, 80% of pins are repins, so there's only very little original content. But I do encourage you to try, and that's something we're gonna do in an exercise. No, it's not. Actually, it's not like that. Everything is similar to Google. Everything is ranked according to algorithms. And I personally found that, number one, the click-throughs and the repins are the most heaviest factors after search. Like, you still need to do your keywords. You need that. But those things will play a role. If you go try to buy the repins, I tried doing that just to test it out. They don't work. They have to be active users, which is why you should email people, bank them to pin, do whatever it takes if you want them to rank for a keyword, but don't just use one, use two or three, because once you start getting repins for Honduras, it influences the search term Philippines as well. So all of a sudden, one is feeding off the other. And so you can imagine when you have three of them, you're feeding into all three at one time, and it's like, wow, that's crazy. Now, if you might be wondering, well, how significant is that? So over here, this pin, which I did for a former client, had over 200,000 monthly impressions, approximately, just through search alone. And because of search, because it ranked very high in search, it ended up getting about 3,600 repins through search results. People loved it, they found it, and the words I aimed for, which I would consider I wouldn't say they're long tail, but for example, box braids is one of them, and the other was braids for black women. And if you're wondering, how do I get that type of information, I'll show you as well. But by doing that, again, combined with a beautiful image, you can do very well with search results. And that's how you really get, here's the funny thing, if you rely on repins to come from your board, they will die over time. If you rely on repins from search, they will go on for a long time. A long time. And when I mean a long time, anywhere between, seriously, 8 months to 2 years. And the funny thing is, once you're on top of the results, and maybe it's not as active, it slowly decreases. Slowly. So it's like a gradual drop. It's not like, oh, I didn't get 100 repins this day, so I'm like, it drops off the face of the earth. It's not like that. It just gradually gets there. The hardest part is getting on the very top. That's the hardest part. So I'm going to try to shock you a little bit. Oh, sorry. Actually, that was... you know, I screwed it up. This is supposed to be first, and then I was supposed to show this. Anyways. Yeah, first speaker problems. So how do you get keyword ideas? When you're on Pinterest, you can, like Google, you can start typing in the words, and Pinterest will tell you what people are searching for. If it's bathroom fa, it'll tell you that people are looking for bathroom faucets, and surprising to me, bathroom farmhouse. I totally did not know that that was a popular search term on Pinterest when you type in bathroom fa. I'm seriously glad that there's no bathroom fart or something like that. Because I was like, if this thing was dominated by guys, this thing would totally change. Yeah. But you can also, but again, another keyword that you may not have thought of that your customers are looking for is bathroom facelift. I just don't think that. But to Pinterest users, they do. And here, when we're talking about long tail keywords, is your friend. Guided search is your best friend. And what guided searches is, they are recommended search terms of tiles that you will see when you do Pinterest search, whether it's on mobile or on desktop. But over here, you might think, okay, I think Pinterest users are looking for bathroom design. But reality is that in a niche perspective, they might be looking for modern bathroom design. They might be looking for luxury bath design, rustic bathroom design. All of a sudden, those niche words that you couldn't get because Google tries to hold back that information, you can now use with your pins and your blog posts to help with your Google and your Bing search rankings, as well as Pinterest. They're giving you that information. So take that extra information and use it in other platforms as well. But so this is really cool, because now what you can do, and this is kind of like, we're going to flex more of your Pinterest muscles, is I want you to go into your Pinterest account and just take a look, whether it's a product or whether it is a service, type in a search word that is relevant to your industry and just write down like five words, like long tail keywords that you can now use within your pins. Just take a look. And if you need a break, maybe you just need a break to get some water, feel free to grab some water as well. You know, it's a loosey-goosey type of workshop. So just five words. Has anybody found some interesting surprises that they weren't expecting? That's really cool. here's as you're writing, I just want to share another thing with you. What's really cool is all the search terms that you're seeing right now are actually country-based or region-based. So these are actually the results that that American users are seeing. / Canadian, we're considered part of the region. But if you go to Germany, Germans will have a different type of search result, right? So it's really interesting.
So those guided search buttons are based on actual search history of people? They're not like suggested or?
Yeah, so this is, sorry, I apologize for interrupting. But yeah, this is based on kind of like the cumulative.
So if it's in a guided search button, that means somebody has typed that word with what the keyword that you have in there?
Yes, yeah, so it means, so not necessarily that they've typed in, but they've kind of noticed that, we notice that for the word modern seems to be associated a lot with bathroom design. It can also mean that fact that lots of people have typed it, but I have tried typing in like really long tail keywords, and again, like nothing shows up in terms of pins. So these are generally the most popular. What I have noticed though, it doesn't necessarily mean that the order is the most popular, but usually like the first few you see are the most popular. You can also actually click on like this arrow button that should be here, and you can get like extensive long tail keywords. So for a client I worked with, corporate travel safety, I did like 50 keywords for them, right? So, and that's a great thing. If you're selling products, you can literally just keep typing and typing and get really niche on that. How many people found a keyword they're just really shocked at that you weren't expecting? Okay. So moving into the bigger picture. So when you are trying to rank well on Google and Pinterest, this is a common mistake I see that solopreneurs make, is that they will put their name in there. So it might be just Patricia Gray. Except the problem is when people are looking for you on Pinterest, they don't know that you're Patricia Gray. They just know your business name. And so what I tell people is that if you're a solopreneur, is to make sure that you put your name in there followed by the business, so that when people do search for you on Pinterest, for let's say that they want to search for interior design in Vancouver, your name and the word interior design Vancouver shows up. So make sure that you put that in your Pinterest business name. Now, if you feel like you yourself, like such as Tony Robbins, you know, the motivational speaker, is a strong enough brand that people aren't going to type in motivational speaker, you can use Tony Robbins. But definitely try to add in one keyword and your name in there so that it maximizes search results. The other thing that you can do, how many people have run into Pinterest boards where there's like really cute names? You ever notice that? Like they're so cute and oh, that's so great. The problem is, it's not that they're not wonderful, and I love the collections that come from them. What disappoints me is that nobody's finding them through search results. Using simple things that you used from the guided search, you can now create boards from that. That's the great thing. So if you were searching for World War II vintage posters, and you needed, it might be black and white, or it might be French vintage posters, whatever comes up, you can create boards for that. So that way, now what happens is that your pins are optimized for search, your account is now optimized for search, and your boards are now optimized for search. You have now maximized all three types of searches. And when you do that, not only are you helping Pinterest out, you're also helping Google out as well. Because how many people here, I'm very curious, how many people here, when they type in something, they notice that a Pinterest result shows up on the first page? Yeah, it's actually very common. It's really common. And so you might as well leverage that to your advantage. So for example, some of my competitors see this, they're probably going to use it. But one of the things I do is that I have used Pinterest to leverage the keyword Pinterest speaker. Because nobody else is using it, I know that Pinterest is good for it. So now if you try to type in Pinterest speaker, I'm usually on the first page somewhere, you know. There's also Pinterest speakers, like the sound speakers, but nobody's looking for that. So you can definitely leverage Pinterest to help you advance for Google as well. Now, in order to try to advance for Google, what you want to do is make sure that your board is being consistently pinned to. So if you only pin one or two items, it's not going to help with the search results. But if you pin to it consistently, it will help with the Google search results, because what happens is Google loves fresh content. And might as well just add it in there, because that's fresh content.
Yeah. So I'm an interior designer, and so I go through and I got, you know, my kitchen faucets and bathroom designs and stuff. How often should I be pinning stuff? I mean, I don't want people to be like, all she does is pin to Pinterest, but I don't want it to be so far between that people think. You know what I mean? What is good but not overdone?
So I'll go about this in a little bit while as well, but generally I tell people in terms of, it really depends on the goal of your business. I would say you're probably gonna go overboard if you start doing more than 20 a day on Pinterest, especially if someone follows all your boards. But generally most people don't follow all your boards anyway, they follow very selective boards. So again, if it's a board that you like, feel free to do up to 3 pins a day. I think, especially if you intersperse it, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, one at night, I think that's okay. I'm not saying you should do that for every board. It's just maybe one board that you really want to focus on. That's okay.
Right now, it's so, I get into a Pinterest mode, and then once you're in Pinterest, it's like hours are lost. And I'll find that, you know, like for bathroom faucets, when I get on, you know, I've posted like 55 pins to that particular board, but then I might not post any or pin anything for a month or 3 weeks. So more often but less pins is what you're saying.
Yeah, and the great thing is when you use Pinterest, you also have access to secret boards. So if you really want to save them for later and then kind of stagger, I would say, your pins for later on, put them on your secret board and then repin them into the public board. What Pinterest does actually reward is that they do reward consistent pinning. So if you are pinning every single day, they like that. They like that you're doing that. What they don't like is, like you're saying, they don't want you to pin like massively. Not because it's bad, it's because it ruins the followers' experiences. I'm sure we've all had that experience where you log into Pinterest and you literally see 30 pins of almost the same type of theme, and you go, I just want to unfollow this person because it's too much. So you want to kind of stagger it. So as I mentioned earlier, what happens is you'll notice that sometimes, most of the time, when you see the search results, is that, again, pins tend to show up. A lot of the pins that have tons of repins will show up in the first search results. If you don't see them, the reason is because it's more of a pin that might have, let's say, 2 repins has like 5,000 repins across Pinterest. So it's not so much about this particular repin number, though it plays a big role. It is really about how many repins you can get. And as I said, something that I encourage you to do when it comes to ranking well for keywords, email your list out, ask people on Facebook to repin your content, try to get that content repinned as much as possible. I really can't stress that enough, because when you see the results, when that happens, you will be so happy. You will be happy. And most people still don't talk about it. Go ahead.
If you send a pin to somebody and they pin it, does that still count as a repin?
It does, yeah. If you send your own pin and they repin it, then it counts. Yeah. The key thing is that they have to be active users. What I mean by active, usually once a month, they have to be on Pinterest. Yeah, so the question is, and this is a valid question, because a lot of people want to know, okay, I get emails from Pinterest regarding pins that I might like, supposedly like. How do I get on that email list? Totally by chance, it's by curation. Usually there's somebody that kind of handpicks that stuff, sometimes it is by algorithm, but the reality is that it's luck of the draw. It's not necessarily the most popular. Sometimes it could be someone with just 200 followers.
Yeah, I've noticed that. I've noticed like they'll send you 2 pins that maybe has like 145 repins, and then maybe one that has 10,000. So it seems all over the place.
It's all over the place, yeah. And the reason they do it all over the place partially is because what they noticed before is that a lot of the pinners, total side note, is a lot of the pinners are getting a lot of followers, and the influencers are starting to work with agencies and making a lot of cash. Like, I'm talking like five figures a month cash. And anybody that tells you when you run a business, if someone's eating into your business, you start cutting them off. It's that simple. Yeah, so that's, so you still get them, but it's surprisingly, it's not as, it is helpful, but it's not as helpful as it used to be. So here's something that's kind of interesting. How many people here by chance knew that search results were gender-based? Here's the funny thing. It is actually gender-based. So when you log into Pinterest and you set up an account and you choose that I'm a woman or I'm a man, or I think they even have like unidentified or something similar like that, they will start showing pins based on what they perceive your gender to be. And so this is really great. So if you go, well, I have a male targeted product, but it sucks for Pinterest, it's kind of not true. So over here, when this is about watches, if I search for this term, these are the types of watches that show up. However, if a woman, according to Pinterest, types in a search, oh, actually, I mixed that up. Did I mix it up? Oh, no. But if a woman types in a search, this is the results they show. And so this is especially true for products, not necessarily for, I would say, general kind of like blog posts, but for products, this is massively huge. So if you think that, well, my products aren't going to be aimed at women, they're going to be aimed at men, that's going to be a problem. It's not. I promise you, you definitely want to use gender-based search results. So here's the thing. A lot of people go, I want to know what the best pinning times are. When should I pin? And here is the absolute truth. Nobody can tell you exactly when the best time to pin is because we all live in different time zones. That's just a reality. So obviously, if you do a lot of business in Alaska and you try to accommodate to pin for, let's say, Hawaii time, but your customers aren't from Hawaii, then you're wasting your time. But using a tool known as Tailwind, so tailwindapp.com, what they will do, and this does cost money, it's about $15 a month. It is a scheduling tool, by the way. You can actually use Tailwind to schedule pins. If you have an e-commerce site and you find it's dreadfully painful to upload like 20 product images at one time through Pinterest, which you cannot do, you can actually do that with Tailwind. But what Tailwind does and what I really love is that they will tell you when the best engagement times, and that usually means when you get the most repins based on the days. So, and you can choose your time zone as well. So they'll tell you Monday that, hey, by the way, 7 o'clock is a good time to pin. On Thursday, 2:52 is a great time. And I can tell you from myself, if you try to pin live all the time, number one, you're gonna go nuts. And number two, you're never gonna find out when your best pinning times are. You can only estimate. But Tailwind will actually tell you. So it's really helpful. It's solely for Pinterest. So if you're really heavy into Pinterest, that's all it's good for. If you are trying to schedule something and you only have like maybe 3 or 4 pins a day, Buffer is a great tool. The only thing I don't like about Buffer, great scheduling, is that Buffer won't give you the detailed analytics that Tailwind will. So Tailwind will actually go through like the history of your last 5,000 pins, and they will tell you like these pins that you've pinned are the most popular. Like these ones got the most repins, whether it's something that you pinned on your own site or something you pinned on somebody else's, they will tell you. So there's a lot of detailed stats on that. So Pinterest advertising. This is something that's still relatively new. People are very curious about it. And this is something I'm gonna tell you. I am so envious of the US because I'm gonna tell you this. Only people that operate businesses in the US have access to promoted pins. Only you guys. None of the Europeans, none of the Canadians have access. So you have access for advertising to a market that you don't need to compete with globally. This is not Facebook. And you should, if it's in your budget, look into this. Because I guarantee you, maybe a year or another 2 years from now, when they open up that platform wide open the way that Google does, you're gonna see these cost per clicks skyrocket. So in order to get promoted pins, you need to have a business account. But you also need to apply. So you need to go to ads.pinterest.com and apply for them. And here's the trick that you want to do, because you have to apply. They're going to go look at your website. They'll ask you, do you have $20,000 a month to spend on your advertising budget with Pinterest? Or do you have below? Just say, yes, I have $20,000 and over. Lie to them, because then it speeds up the process. So, and they don't really fall. They're not gonna, it's not one of those, it's not like, oh, this person has $20,000, we're gonna call them and we're gonna try to sell them. It's not like that. It's just more for their information. So choose the higher priced marketing budget. So when you're doing promoted pins, what you have to do is that you have to choose a pin that you've already publicly posted. So it cannot be a pin that you have created just for that advertisement. It doesn't work that way. But once you've chosen it, what you can do is you can choose, for example, the specific keywords you want to aim for. You can choose the device, you can choose the gender, and you can choose the city. So what happens is that you can, if you want to target people in Anchorage, Alaska, you can do that. That's the great thing. So with promoted pins, you can target people, for example, in Seattle. If you're trying to get people to come from Seattle to Alaska for tourism, then you can definitely do that as well. The one thing I don't like about promoted pins, which they've changed recently, is that before they used to actually tell you what you could expect in terms of the amount of searches for your terms. So if you, let's say that you want to choose iPhone user, Anchorage, Alaska, for the search term Alaska tourism. They used to tell you that there would be about 400 searches or 5,000 or whatever it was. They've taken all that away now, unfortunately. So you do actually have to spend money on promoted pins to find out what exactly is going on. I have to tell you the honest truth. If you're going to use promoted pins and you have an advertising budget, I would strongly recommend that you look into Facebook retargeting. Because, and this is going to be a stunning fact, if you look at your stats, generally what I find is that, number one, you're going to get a lot of new traffic from Pinterest users. Lots. Number two, they're just going to browse very quickly and probably spend the least amount of time on your site most of the time. So they're not very, I would say, deep customers. Number three, the bounce rates are very high, like incredibly high compared to Facebook or others. And the reason why is because you're always attracting new visitors. It's not like you're building a community. You can, the reality is you have followers on Pinterest, but they're not really seeing everything you see. That's the problem. So if you are in a business that has advertising budget, promote a pin, let it go to a blog post, let it go to a product page, but then to get their attention again, you want to use retargeting either for Facebook or if you use a program like AdRoll to get their attention again. Pinterest doesn't allow retargeting, which kind of sucks, because then you're just spending money to advertise again and again. But take a look at it, really take advantage. And the great thing is that they'll tell you, like if you're worried about your budget, they'll kind of tell you where your bidding is. So they'll tell you, okay, you can bid between 40 cents to 94 cents. That's kind of the general gist. You can also bid not based on cost per click, but what they call cost per engagement, which I think is a total ripoff. So a CPE, cost per engagement, is when someone chooses to repin, close up on your pin, or click, you can pay for that action. So it might be 15 cents per action. And I can tell you, for a lot of e-commerce sites, you're gonna get a lot of close-ups, but you're not gonna get a lot of clicks sometimes. And it can get very expensive with no results. But with cost per click campaigns, what's really great about them is free repins for all. So they don't charge you for repins, and they don't charge you for clicks of those repins as well. So here's something that I wanted to talk about, which is Bank of America. So Bank of America used Better Money Habits, which is a site they started, and they were able to use promoted advertising to get approximately 29,000 repins of everything that was going on. So there is some validity in using promoted pins to reach new people. What I really want to talk a little bit about is the Better Money Habits strategy, right? And I think this is something that's very important to businesses. I should just kind of curious, how much time do I have left? I'm supposed to have
You're right at 11:35 right now.
Okay, and I think it's supposed to end at what time?
11:35.
Okay, so this is perfect, because this is where I really wanted to end it a little bit, is here's Bank of America. So what they did was that they looked for popular topics. So they would go, you know, they knew for a fact that money, saving money, saving for, like, buying a home, budgeting basics, wedding planning, child plans, these are all hot topics on Pinterest, all of them. They decided that we are no longer going to let mommy bloggers do that. We're going to take the power, we're going to create this content, and we're going to create great pins for that. And by doing that, by creating resources, guess what? Again, Bank of America, which you would never expect because it's called Better Money Habits, has now driven, like, I don't know how much traffic, but 29,000 repins, that's a fair amount of repins for 3,300 followers, right? So create great pins, use text if necessary, and make sure it applies to that pain, and that's popular on Pinterest.
Hey, Randy.
So that pretty much, so we won't go into the other slides because it generally talks a little bit more about everything else, but see what's hot, be a tease, solve the pain, design for mobile, get rich pins, create a sibling for your pin, repin popular pins, perform that magic trick, SEO your pins, pin at the best times, and try promoted pins if it's within your budget. Perfect. And so I don't think we have time for questions, but I think we are pretty much on a break right now. So if you do have any questions, I'm going to be outside in the hallway. I'll be happy to answer everybody's questions in detail. But again, thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate it. And I'm so honored to be at, like, Alaska's first inbound marketing summit. Awesome.